If I mention the name John Hemmingham, all his fans will go, I know John, all his family will know John. If you don't know John, I can guarantee you will have heard him if you've seen big football matches. All the music you hear going in the background is John and his band. John is the leader of the official England football band. Welcome, John.
Yeah, very nice to speak to you, Lars.
Good stuff, nice to speak to you. Now, we are obviously in lockdown. It's dominating all our interviews. But it must have affected you big time in the band, because you either be at Croatia, an FA this, a football that. You must be missing it big time.
Yeah, it's devastating, actually. Yeah, we had all the year's work wiped out in 2 days in March, unfortunately. We should have been to the Euros. We were going to Australia. We were doing friendly games in Estonia and Austria, Denmark and Iceland next month, but they're behind closed doors. We've missed a load of rugby games. It's you'll have me crying before so long, Lars. It's awful.
Yeah, it really is bad. I mean, we're all talking about musicians in bands who are missing out, but I mean, the football fixtures as well. It's such a shame. How many is in the actual band, the England band?
Well, we go up and down in numbers, but there's a hardcore of 5 or 6, and then we go up to 15. So there's quite a few, and obviously everybody affected, and it's just such a shame. There's nothing we can do about it, is there? It's just hang on in there and hope for the best when it comes out.
Yeah, that's right. But it's not just football. What else? I think you do hockey and even boxing?
Yeah, we do. We've done Vegas 5 times with Ricky Hatton with the boxing, and we do amateur boxing as well. We've done George Groves, Chris Eubank Jr., a few others, and the hockey we do for the Olympic team, so the women's and the men's Great Britain. We've done a couple of Olympics with them and other games, and so yeah, we get around a few sports, and like I say, rugby league internationals, as well as domestic games, and of course the football with England, but not only the men, the women and the under 21s as well. So yeah, from a full programme to nothing, anything that we do needs a crowd, you see. So crowds at the moment are banned, and we're just stuck.
Yeah, you must be missing it big time. I mean, this is widely travelled, isn't it? Boxing matches in Las Vegas, that's just something else. Are you playing, I mean, when we hear you, we have the Steve McQueen, the Great Escape, all that sort of stuff in the background. Is there a favourite song?
There's not. It tends to be sort of trendier songs that are in vogue at the time, with certain, you know, certain songs become popular. I mean, Russia a couple of years ago, we made one up about drinking all their vodka and stuff like this. And it was Earth, Wind and Fire. Which, you know, oh, da-da-da-da-da-da, oh, da-da-da-da. Dancing in September, I think it's called, something like that. And we put words to that about drinking all their vodka. That went down really well because it was obviously Russia. That was good. So they sort of come in and out. The sort of staple one, The Great Escape, is one that everybody knows. And we've been playing that for a lot of time, a long time since... Well, we started in 93 and we've been playing it ever since then. Everybody sort of knows that and expects that to be played at some stage. And it's now usually a song that we play when we've got the job done, if you like, when the victory's in the can and we're sort of last few minutes.
Drinking all the vodka. Well, I love it. So, I mean, that bumpty, 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 how does that sort of transmit round the ground with all these people making so much noise, rattling things? Do you set up at the halfway line of this end or that end behind the goal? Is there an acoustic area that works best?
So we're always at the back, and obviously for us, once you start a song, we're usually in the middle of the noisiest area anyway. But when you start a song and it catches on, and then the whole stadium, so you can have 90,000 singing at Wembley, a song that you've just started yourself, it's a great feeling, and we know it's working then. And obviously the idea is that it spurs the team on.
You're halfway through a song, And there's a goal. Do you have to sort of stop that song and play a specific song for a goal?
Obviously, if we score, then everybody goes mad, and you've just got to make sure you don't get your trumpet bashed into your front teeth. And we're equally as celebratory as all the fans around us, so we're jumping about, and you have to make sure your mouthpiece is still in there when you've finished jumping about. So usually when we score, the mouthpiece comes out in one hand, the trumpet in the other, and we're all jumping around. And then when it settles a little bit, we do often nowadays we'll do the White Stripes, you know, Seven Nation Army. And then probably if the player that scored has got his own individual song, we'll pick out that and do a song with his name in it. And again, hopefully get a bit of a wave for him, give him a boost, or her, and go from there.
And there have been occasions where the camera, you know, has focused on the band. You're really giving it some. How do you rehearse? I mean, are you scattered all over the country? Do you sort of rehearse over the internet, or do you meet somewhere?
Three or four are based in Sheffield, but then we've got members from Norfolk, London, Scarborough, Leeds up the road, all over the place, really. But one of the things that we pride ourselves on is I think we've only had one rehearsal in 27 years that we've been doing it, and that was a complete disaster.
One rehearsal in 27 years. I've been in a few bands like that.
The reason it was a disaster was one of the lads decided to throw a stink bomb in the rehearsal room. So that was the end of that.
So trumpet playing, brass playing, big audiences all the way around the world. Do you think this is encouraging young people, older people, whoever, to pick up the brass instrument?
I'm sure it is, yeah. We know it is because we've been contacted by a lot of parents of kids who have been inspired, who probably wouldn't have been inspired before, you know, because it happens at football, that gives them the inspiration, or rugby or whatever, it gives them the inspiration to pick it up, whereas they might not have been exposed to that normally.
That's a lot of travelling, John, all the way around the world. What made you choose Fusion Gig Bags?
Well, you did, Lars, to be honest. It was your recommendation, and they've proved to be very, very successful. We've got the big one that the trumpet goes in. The main thing with that is that it does protect it, because we don't want any disasters of squashed instruments. But not only that, the quality of them and the number of pockets, it's obviously well thought out. The number of pockets that are on there for all your stuff when you're travelling, it's really important. Passports, that kind of thing. They're just great. I love them.
John, it's been a delight to talk to you. Something a little bit different. Let's hope we see you out there pretty soon supporting England once again.
It would be lovely to get back in a stadium supporting the teams as we did before. Looking forward to it.
I'm sure it'll happen soon. Thanks ever so much, John.
Thanks, Lars. Good to speak to you.